Ever felt like your shell requires a bit too much configuration to do basic stuff? 10 years ago, as a fresh developer, I remember staring at my white terminal running bash, feeling like I was decoding an alien language, which, if we're honest, is kind of what bash is. Statistically speaking, most of you are running Z shell, a POSIX compatible shell, probably with all my ZSH on top if you're in the vast majority of the spectrum. But have you ever considered venturing out? I didn't, never bothered with exploring anything but what I either knew or saw others use online. So today I want to show you options and open your mind. You won't necessarily change your ways, but together we're going to be at least more informed. We'll explore bash, the born again shell, Z shell, and finally, their modern yet different alternative, fish. We'll talk about the whys, the hows, the differences to help you make a wiser choice. With that in mind, let's get started. I'm running Z shell, which is much like bash, meaning it's POSIX compatible. POSIX stands for Portable Operating System Interface, which basically means it's a standard for creating operating systems, APIs, and CLIs. You know, your ls, cd, pwd, dot dot and dot notation for directory structure, traversal, etc. Where bash and others differ though starts with the configuration file, the famous bashrc or bash profile. Bash brought a scripting language to the world that can both be used in .sh executable files as well as inline in the shell, like echoing 0, which is a statement always resulting in the exit code 0, which is the equivalent bash for true, or using the AND operator together with it to form conditionals. Now, I'm not going further with this because that's not the reason we're here, but if you're interested in a dedicated bash tricks and tips, please do share this in the comments. One of the best things about bash, a concept also copied by many other shells, is VI mode. Set -o VI turns VI mode on and allows us to escape to normal mode just like Vim. The default escape key is, well, escape, which then lets you use basic Vim motions like B to jump backwards or W and E to jump forward to the beginning or end of words respectively. With some additions or in more modern setups, there's also the indication as part of the shell prompt for the current mode. Just like in Vim, I moves back to insert mode to make further changes. Hit V, where instead of an inline visual mode, the command will be sent to the configured editor under $editor variable for more in-depth changes. This comes in handy with long commands with many flags. AWS and Kubernetes comes to mind here, but this is extremely useful in many other situations. Another bash specific file is where history is kept. By default, this is bash underscore history in the home directory, showing a list of recent commands accessible through a file or by simply hitting history in the shell. If you want persistency for your history that's running in a fuzzy search and backed by a local DB, check out my setup with Atuin in the video above. POSIX variables are set using the export command, and these are later accessible from anything running on the same process, like a statement printing success if a variable is missing or failure if it's there. POSIX allows for local variable configuration. It also standardized the $home and $path where preloaded binaries are loaded and accessible from. And we must not forget the concept of exit codes I mentioned briefly earlier, where 0 marks a successful run and bad commands can result in all kinds of codes, like 127 for command not found, for example. This is enough bash, let's move to a bit more modern known alternative, Z shell. Similarly, Z shell uses the zsh underscore history to find its own command history, and beyond mild differences, what's important about it is that it's POSIX compatible. This means every inline bash command we used earlier is still valid in zsh. If you're a Mac user and started the terminal utility in the past couple of years, you've probably seen Z shell as the default replacing bash with the release of macOS Catalina. ZSH has a thriving established community around it, building tools like ZSH for Humans that sets a list of plugins working out of the box, bringing features like syntax highlighting, auto completions and suggestions, and a shared command history with one installation. There are also plenty of prompts like oh my posh, setting your command line with sections and colorful, easy to track information, or Starship RS, which is my personal choice and you can find more in the video above. There's also ZVM, a better VI mode for ZSH. This is a cool little plugin that sets you up with insert and replace, inline visual mode, redo, undo, copy, cut and paste. Since I really liked finding about it, I'll quickly show it off by adding it to my Nix Flake as a shell program and run Darwin home to set me up. I can now do even cooler stuff with VI mode, like visually selecting text in a surrounding pair of parentheses, deleting within them, selecting a word with VIW, then yanking it with Y, selecting again, using VI and opening parentheses, and pasting the yanked word. This thing makes VI mode a little more Vim-like, and I absolutely love it. Even Vim plugins that do not come by default with the Vim itself, like the famous Vim Surround is available here, allowing me to delete the surrounding quotes with DS double quote, undo the motion, change it with CS double quote, then a single quote or any other character. Another popular and highly recommended addition is Zenit, a fast ZSH plugin manager, allowing for easy plugin management if you find yourself often updating your setup. Lastly, before upgrading to the real modern shell alternative, we can't ignore the gigantic elephant in the room, OhMyZSH. This is one of the most popular projects across all of GitHub, with over 170,000 stars, making ZSH amazing on almost every platform. With its own plugin management prompt configuration, theme selection, and other handy features, it's no wonder OhMyZSH is so popular. I made a few videos covering it, including a video of me upgrading to Starship down the road, and if you want the TLDR, it's me feeling OhMyZSH configuration was a bit bloated and raw. I wanted something lighter and faster to use. Okay, let's move on to the real reason we're here. Fish is a friendly interactive shell and a smart and user-friendly command line shell for Linux, macOS, and the rest of the family. Fish comes with lots of basics, Bash and ZSH don't. It comes with syntax highlighting, paths marked to separate the prompt structure, it shows exit codes and other cool additions without you ever having to tweak, install, or configure anything. In addition to aliases, Fish comes with abbreviations, shortened to ABBR command, so we can set foo to echo hi and type foo, and that's immediately expanded to the configured abbreviation in line. Kind of like Expanso, which I've talked about before, but for the terminal. Another huge selling point of Fish is its auto-completion. Here's changing directory backward and the available options that I can also scroll through if I keep hitting tab. The same goes for all other command completions like AWS CLI. Fish can also suggest basic commands. If I type CD and tab before completing the command, it'll suggest alternatives. When commands return a non-zero exit code, Fish will show it briefly in the subsequent line afterwards. Here's a failed non-existing command resulting in 127 exit code shown in red. With Bash, I'd have to echo $?, and with ZSH, I can only see the exit code because I added a custom prompt on top. Now for some differences. Trying to set a variable inline pops an error, but also a useful explanation. Fish doesn't support the equal operator inline. Instead, you'd want to use a set operator like so. Set sum to thing and then use it. And again, trying to set sum equal thing, whether by mistake or because of a forgotten syntax, pops another useful error message. Fish is definitely a friendly shell, or at least friendlier than the alternatives. If you recall earlier, we did say there's one major difference, and the fact that setting variables is trickier here is part of it. Fish is not POSIX compliant. This means that some features are missing, or just different. Some scripts, like the simple loop over 10 numbers sequence in Bash, may still run. Others naturally won't because of the lack of compliance or just different language. But this is easily mitigated by adding a small shebang on top, referring the execution to Bash. With Fish scripts, however, these have to run with the Fish prompt itself. Beyond all of the above, Fish is just nice to use. It separates everything using nice colors, it underlines file names, and it's overall an ideal user experience considering the zero configuration involved. But here's something so cool and thoughtful of the user, I bet you've never seen it with any other shell. Fish has a fish_config command that launches a web server with a configuration dashboard where you can view, update and change your configuration using a web interface. You can see your current set variables, command history, your bindings, and even shell colors and themes you can play with and change to your liking. Fish is truly, truly a user-friendly shell. The one thing we didn't cover yet is how Fish differs from Bash in its scripting language. This is something I'll leave for another time. Let me know in the comments if that's of interest, and I'll do another video covering the language specifically, its benefits and drawbacks when it comes to scripting your shell. So you can now pick your new shell or at least know the available options. But even the best of them isn't complete with all the modern features when it comes to configuring a prompt. If you want to add some magic, like showing your Go version, whether this is a Python or JavaScript project, to help you avoid mistakes, maybe pop your current AWS region or note the presence of a Docker file. You have to check out Starship on the video right here. Thank you for watching, and I'll see you on the next one.